Welcome to the third DevOps, Kitchener-Waterloo DevOps meetup. This meetup started last September, I think. In the first week we had 50 people, and that checked.
At Tim
Hortons. Yeah, Tim Hortons. And then,
that's where
now, last I checked, my mouth dropped. There's 356 people in our meetup. We're quite the large meetup. I think one of the large,
huge. Bigger than the AWS meetup.
And that's all thanks to the people here that signed up and shown a lot of interest in DevOps. DevOps, as a practice, is pretty hot right now. The just in terms of where you can go and what you can do, but the technology, you'll find it's really cool. There's always something interesting that you can do with it. Maybe hoping that you'll find something that you've never thought of to do with these tools, and you can take that back and just build upon it, right? And then share it back to the community. When this meetup started, it was kind of cool. We seeded it with a couple of presentations, and then we got more interest. We had someone else take an interest and volunteer to present something, and then this is the third iteration of that, where someone took an interest, saw somewhere where we could build upon something, and was willing to present that. I understand that in our field and who we are, people might not want to stand up here and present, but that's fine. If you have something you want to present, we could probably find someone that can set up here for you on your behalf. And just, we want to be able to share our knowledge. All right. So tonight, I want to thank Index Exchange for hosting this venue. This is a really gorgeous office. It really is. You have to be here to just look at it. It's amazing. I'll have James just give a little blurb on what Index Exchange is, and then we'll get into a presentation by Stefan Panay on Kubernetes architecture. And then we'll have Pavel, I think we'll take a little break and then have Pavel present the integration with Jira and Jenkins after that. Right. So without much further ado, James.
Well, thank you very much, Raymond, and thanks for the kind words about the office. My name is James Kostiuk. I've been here at Index for a little over 3 years now, and I just want to give a little bit of info about what we do here. We're an ad exchange, which means that we connect advertisers with publishers or people who host websites that have impressions or ad space that they want to sell. And I know what you're thinking. You are those guys that make me see that picture of a vacuum cleaner 3 months after I bought it, and we don't, or we try not to, at least. The other guys, I promise. What we do try and focus on is the best experience for you and for the publishers to help keep the internet free and to minimize load times, things like that. Milliseconds matter, and we get really passionate about that kind of tech here. The other thing that's very interesting about Index Exchange is that it's actually family owned. There's no investors, and that's really given us a unique space in the industry that we're able to pivot very quickly, and it's allowed us to grow very rapidly in the past, well, at least 3 years since I've been here. We've doubled year over year over year, which means that we now have the talent, like Stefan, the offices, like this, and the free time, like right now, to start joining these events and helping host them. So we're really happy to be able to start giving back a little bit, and to do just that, Stefan. Thank you.
I've been presenting the Kubernetes architecture. I guess while I have the audiences here, just put a plug there. If anyone wants to sponsor a venue, let us know. The next venues or the next meetup, it all depends on whether or not we can find a space large enough to host the meetup. There's, we can work out something to get the next one going. And it also depends on just topics and getting someone up here to present something, all right?
Thanks for coming. My name is Stefan, as James mentioned, and actually James and I started at around the same time with Index. And I'm an operations engineer with Index Exchange. I've been working with Kubernetes in the last little while. And I want to share some of the interesting things that I found, especially as it relates to Kubernetes architecture. I have to be a little bit closer to see my notes. So, you know, just to get introduced to Kubernetes and cover some of the overview stuff, the term Kubernetes is actually originally Greek and it refers to helmsman or pilot. You may probably know that Kubernetes is an open source project. You can find it on GitHub. It is almost entirely built in Golang. And this is the really interesting stuff. Has anyone heard of Borg? No hands? Borg. B-O-R-G. So Borg was the first cut at orchestration. And it was designed and built internally at Google. We now know this because a lot of engineers who worked at Google left and wrote about it. You can read about Borg in their, one of the places you can read about it is in the Google SRE book. So Borg was the first cut at orchestrating containers. Not long after Borg, as with all software, people who were using it started skirting the intended workflows. So they were using it, but not in the way that it was intended to be used, right? And so Google said, fine, we're going to take a second cut at orchestration, and they called this Omega. And then a few years back, when Docker exploded, I'm guessing the majority of you are familiar with Docker. Okay. When Docker exploded, Google said, so, you know, we have all of this orchestration experience internally, and now containers are mainstream. Why don't we do something about this? And so they designed Kubernetes. And Kubernetes was built and designed based on their experience running orchestration systems at a large scale in production for over a decade at this time. And you know what's really cool is Google is a maintainer, but it's also open source, so you can see all of the design principles that they've included and the decisions that they've made, and you can contribute if you'd like to. So throughout the talk, I'm going to be referring to some design decisions and some design principles. Extensibility, resiliency, and performance are like the three things that will continuously come up. Before I get to the next slide, I have half an hour, and I chose to talk about Kubernetes architecture. So you might be thinking, how the hell do you cover Kubernetes architecture in half an hour? It's an enormous project. There's a lot going on. So this is what I decided to do. Who's familiar with kubectl? Your hands. You guys have probably all used Docker, like Docker run, Docker exec. Okay, that's what kubectl is. So kubectl is just a command line that lets you interface with the Kubernetes API. So when you do Docker run, it's basically converting your command line arguments and sending them to the backend, the Docker API. So this command is gonna run an image, an Nginx image, and it's going to give us three replicas. And what we're going to do is we're going to follow this command all the way from where it begins with kubectl till we get what we want, till the cluster does what we want it to do. And as we follow the command, we're going to talk about all the different components that are responsible for making this happen. By the way, if you have any questions throughout the talk, just put up your hand and interrupt me. Okay. So I started introducing kubectl a little bit. Let's get into a little bit more detail. On the right, you can see what a manifest might look like. And again, if you've worked with Docker Compose, this is really just an advanced version of Docker Compose. You can put a lot more information. You can be a lot more descriptive about what you like. And that command that we just ran is essentially going to generate something like this for us. But if we go in order, the first thing that kubectl is going to do is it's going to validate our command. If we're trying to do something stupid, like if the syntax is incorrect, it'll tell us right away. It doesn't need to do anything else to do that validation. The next thing it'll do is it'll use a generator. And the generators are based on the object that you're working with. Kubernetes has a bunch of different objects, deployments, replica sets, etc. And it knows that because you're asking for three replicas, you want a deployment. And so it's going to use the deployment generator to serialize this and construct an HTTP request. So now it has this HTTP request, and before it can send it out to the API, it needs to figure out how to do that. So it's going to read the kubeconfig that it's expecting to be in that directory. That kubeconfig will tell it things like, what's the endpoint for the API? How does it authenticate to the API? What API version is it supposed to use? And then it sends the request. So the request gets to the API. First thing the API does is it runs through an authentication chain. So remember, authentication is basically verifying who I am, right? And the way the authentication chain works is as follows. There are a bunch of different handlers. They get run in a particular order, and only one of them has to succeed. So here's some of the handlers. You can be using certs. You can use a bearer token, which is basically a token that you configure the API at runtime with. You pass the token into the API when you start the API, and then any requests with that token are automatically authenticated, or you can just use basic auth. And assuming that any one of these have passed, the API will remove the authorization header in the request, and then it will add the user information to the request. So the next step is the authorization chain. Very similar idea, right? A bunch of handlers, they're run in order, only one needs to succeed. And remember, authorization is asking, do you have access to do what you want to do? So we've confirmed we know who you are. Now we're trying to find out, can you actually do what you want to do? Are you allowed to do this? So here are some examples of handlers that are available in Kubernetes for authorization. Webhook, role-based access control, and Node. Webhook is really cool. Webhook, basically what it does is it lets you configure Kubernetes to make an HTTP request to another endpoint. So I don't have to define my authorization strategy in Kubernetes. I can offload that to another service, and I can tell it to just hit this service and do whatever it tells you to do. And so if this works, assuming one of these pass, right, the next step is the admission chain. And you might be a little bit confused as to why there's another step, because we've authorized you and we've authenticated you. So why can't you just go do what you want to do? Well, Kubernetes introduced this idea of an admission chain. And this is like a logical check, right? We're about to commit some desired state. And based on what we want to do, we can logically make some decisions. For example, if you remember that command, I only specified an image name and a replica number. But in Kubernetes, when you create objects, there's lots of different information that you include. There's labels and all this other stuff. So where would we add defaults? Well, this is one place where we could add defaults, right? This is also a place where we can impose limitations. For example, we can configure Kubernetes to say, I'm not going to run any objects that refer to images other than this registry. So if we want to grab all our images from one particular registry, you can impose that at the admission chain level. So you can kind of see between the authorization chain, the authentication chain, the admission chain, how this promotes extensibility, right? I can easily add my own handler to any of those chains. It's very clear what the responsibility of each handler is. It's very clear what order the handlers are run in. And so, assuming we pass the admission chain, which we do, the next step is give API commits to etcd. So there was something else I wanted to mention with role-based access control. It's quite granular. So you're able to define roles, and in those roles you can define resources and verbs. So resources might be something like pods or deployments for networking, and verbs might be something like get or watch or list. So you can very clearly define which accounts have access to what. This actually makes it easier to plug into the cluster, because you can be confident that the plugins you're running don't have access to anything that they shouldn't. Okay, I mentioned etcd, and etcd is the next step here. But I want to talk a little bit about etcd before we just say, okay, it commits the data. So what exactly is etcd? Well, etcd is a distributed key value store. So if there are a bunch of others. There's like Zookeeper, there's Consul. And if you're working with clustering technology, you've probably touched one of these key value stores. Etsy also implements the RAF consensus algorithm, which I want to talk about a little bit. I think it's really cool, and that's what enables it to be very resilient. And it also implements watches. So watches are this idea that if somebody wants to know when something changes, they shouldn't have to poll, right? So when I refer to polling, what I mean is constantly checking some backend, some database, to see if some values have changed. Instead, they can register a watch, and SD will inform them when something has changed. And you can see how this impacts performance, right? Because when you're polling, you're making a lot of requests, and you're adding load into your system. Watches let you optimize that. SED is also built in Golang. Everything seems to be built in Golang in the Kubernetes community. So I want to talk about the RAF consensus algorithm. Has anyone looked at this before? Is anyone even remotely familiar with this? A little bit? Okay. So part of what etcd has to do in order for it to be resilient is it has to do a leader election. So you have, let's say, three nodes, and those three nodes have to decide amongst themselves who is the leader. Otherwise, you can run into split brain scenarios, right? We need only one person to be able to make decisions at a time, or in this case, one node. And it has chosen to do that implementing RAF. RAF is well-regarded because it's one of the easier-to-understand algorithms for accomplishing this. It was specifically designed to be easier to understand. That was one of the major motivations when RAF was designed. So in a RAF consensus algorithm, there are three states. There's follower, candidate, and leader. So you can imagine we have three database nodes. They all come up at the same time, and they all start as follows, right? So not really doing anything right now. Every single node implements a random timeout. I'm just gonna go to the next slide to give you a visualization. So you can see in the first quadrant, there are three nodes. The first node has a 200 millisecond timeout, the next one has 250, and the last one has 150, right? So the idea is it's important that they have random timeouts.
How do you establish that timeout at the start there?
It's established when the node comes up.
Is it just part of the startup description?
There are some details into how you guarantee that they're different, but really the most important thing is that they're not all the same. Because then you can run into scenarios where they all try to do the same thing at the same time. So as a follower, you really only have a few responsibilities. One, you have to vote. And all followers vote. This might be a little bit different than what you're used to in our society, but all followers vote. We program them to do this. And they only allow to vote once. They have to vote for the first vote request that they receive. So if a follower doesn't receive any information, no one tells the follower that they're the leader, so the follower has no idea who a leader is. After their timeout expires, the follower says, forget it, I'm gonna be a leader. So they transition into a candidate state. Right? As a candidate, they're gonna send out a request for votes to all of the nodes that are available. If they win the majority of the votes, they're now the leader. If they don't, they just cycle back into being a candidate over and over and over until somebody is chosen as a leader, until a candidate receives information that there is another leader, then they will move to a follower. And you can visualize this here. In the first quadrant, we have three nodes, all with different timeouts. In quadrant B, we notice that the bottom node timed out first because it had the smallest timeout. And so it sent out votes to the other two nodes, right? Those other two nodes said, sure, why not? This is the first request I've received, so I'm gonna vote for you. Bottom node got the majority of votes, so it's the leader. And then the rest of what it does is, every cycle, it will send a ping to all of the followers, giving them information and redeclaring its leadership, right? And that way, if the leader ever goes away, those guys will eventually time out and start their own election process.
Can I ask a kind of a crazy question?
Yes.
Just going back to my So your example shows 3, which is an odd number.
Yes.
You always have odd number of nodes.
Yes.
Okay.
It's important.
Because if you have an even number, you could find race condition where I can see it in the back of my head where a couple of nodes would have, especially if you have time outage.
Yes.
Right? So nodes would have a couple of votes, right?
So yes.
They would both get votes for, and the whole cluster would be.
It actually just won't work with an even number because Raft is programmed to only accept leaders on a majority. And the majority is determined based on the total number. So if we know that there are 5 nodes in the cluster, we need to get 3 votes or more in order to elect a leader. So if you have 4 nodes and you get 2 votes, you can't do anything with them.
So then it would expire just
endlessly. You would never get a leader.
It'd just be an endless loop.
So the purpose is to provide consistency of a distributed database.
Yes.
So there are no like sharding situation where one database has just a portion and another one other portion. Then they have to kind of synchronize.
No. To my knowledge, no. Yes.
Is the criteria for voting just the first node to act as leader? Or is there some other criteria for
the first node to, sorry, can you
hear to ask to be a
yes.
leader?
Yes.
So it just, I ask, nobody else has asked, I'm leaving.
Bingo.
Okay.
I was just gonna say that it's elegant in its simplicity, right? We don't need to do anything else. We don't need to set some like predetermined priority between the nodes. Whichever one asks first gets leadership.
So performance is actually based on the timeout, right? The lowest timeout.
Potentially, yes. If the timeouts are large, then you may have to wait a longer time for a new leader to be established.
Right. So how is that true?
How is that?
The timeout not being too large, you know, like, so that performance is not affected?
There's a range. Okay. So it's configured to have a particular range, and that is adjustable, right? There are best practices, but generally it's a few hundred milliseconds.
So in this Raft protocol, you assume that all participants are honest.
Yeah. Yes.
If someone is not, then
yeah.
doesn't work.
Yeah. Now, a caveat: what I presented to you is a small portion of the Raft protocol. It's the big ideas involved in electing a leader. There's a lot of additional information that you need to wrap your head around in how information gets relayed between the leader and the follower. And there's a whole bunch of other scenarios that you can look at, especially for establishing whether like authentication, right? Is this node what says it is?
So the leader actually dictates the consistency of the database.
Yes.
Yeah. And the followers have to replicate.
Exactly.
So if a follower has some discrepancy, then he overwrites what he has with what the leader says.
Yes. You can run into scenarios where your cluster, let's say you have 3 nodes and they become separated from a network perspective, and there are 2 nodes that think they become master, right? And so when they reconnect, they have to be able to decide which is the real master, and they take that master's decisions.
Yeah, I have general information about Raft where I was reading about Paxos algorithm that
predecessor.
Yeah. Some blockchains try to use consensus using Paxos. There are a lot of discussion about who really understands Paxos.
And like I said, that was one of the major motivations for Raft, is that Paxos was really difficult to wrap your head around. I guess it's also worth mentioning that when your database goes down, that doesn't mean that your cluster goes down. It just means that you can't make changes to your cluster. So the state should remain. And that will be clear as we go through the rest of the workflow.
So if the leaders go down, then you have like a delay to establish consensus till the leader is elected to the other nodes, yeah?
Yes. So the next step in this process, we've committed this data, right? Just to recap, we used kubectl, we wrote to the API wrote to the database, and so now we have this key value data in the database. And the next thing that's going to happen is this concept of an initializer, which is very, very similar to an admission controller. controllers, not controller, but admission handlers. So one of the drawbacks of admission handlers is that they have to be compiled into the Qube API. If you want to add new ones, you have to merge it into the Qube API code, and you have to build a Golang package with those handlers. Initializers don't need to do that. They can sit outside. You can have just a container in the cluster that acts as an initializer. And other than that, they're basically the same. There's a list of initializers. And when an object is added into the database, these initializers can take their turns, and they can modify that object in any way that they want. So why this is so powerful is because it allows things like sidecar automation. What I mean by sidecar is when you deploy an application, you may want to have a side application that's also deployed with the main one. And you may want to do this for every single application you deploy. One example of this, although I don't recommend it, is for logging, right? If you want to centralize your logs, you deploy an API, and alongside that API, you also deploy an agent like FileView or FluentD, which is responsible for shipping the logs. So you can automate that where every single pod you create has another container injected into it. And initializers will let you do this. Again, think about the extensibility component of this, right?
So you're suggesting within containers, containers within containers?
No. It's, so this is a challenge because I'm kind of diving right into Kubernetes, and I'm not really sure how much to cover, but are you familiar with the concept of pods?
A little bit.
Okay.
The last presentation for what you were going to say.
Right. So one of the differences between pods and containers, a pod is a group of containers. Right? If you think about a container, it has its own networking namespace, its own file system, its own users, processes, all of these isolations. Okay? A pod is a group of containers and is the smallest divisible unit in Kubernetes. You cannot create a container in Kubernetes. You must create a pod. That pod may have a container or more containers. The only caveat here is that all of the containers in a pod share volumes and share network. So you can't have multiple containers in a pod bind to the same port. That port would be used. So in this case, a sidecar would just be, you have a pod, which is an API, which is really just a container, and then you create another container in that same pod, which is your FileView agent, and that's what we call a sidecar.
Thanks.
So initializer has done its work. Data is still in the database. The next step is it's going to be picked up by a controller. And before I talk about what that does, I'm going to talk about the controller manager concept as a whole. So it's multiple logical processes in one real process. So we only have one PID in reality. It's just a Go binary that's running. But logically, inside of that, there are actually multiple controllers. And this is the first time that we come to this idea of a reconciliation loop, which is probably the most fundamental idea in Kubernetes, right? And reconciliation loop looks at two things, the current state and the desired state, right? So you define what state you want through configuration, and we did that at the very beginning through kubectl. We said we want 3 replicas of this image. That's our desired state. And so the cluster is going to work to get us there. Something to note here is that because we have multiple controllers living in one process, they use watch. So they're basically responsible for paying attention for changes in the database. Right? Whenever, let's choose an example. One of the controllers is a deployment controller. It's responsible for managing deployments, which is an object in Kubernetes. So that controller needs to know whenever there's a change to a deployment object. And so the way that it does that is it registers a watch to the Qube API. And that way, whenever the Qube API writes a change to etcd that modifies a deployment object, it also sends a notification over to this controller saying, hey, this object has changed. And this controller maintains a queue of all the things it needs to do in case there's lots of stuff coming in. But there's a few things here that we can do to optimize. So we've already chosen to use watch for performance.
The other thing is, if we have multiple controllers, let's say we have six controllers, right? Some of those controllers are interested in the same objects. It's not unreasonable. Would it make sense for, let's say, three controllers to all register watches for the same object? And so when the API fires off that watch, it has to send the same request three times to those three separate controllers? Not really, especially because they're all in one place. So they implement this pattern called informer. So the informer takes care of all of this back and forth between the API and the controller manager. And all of the controllers running in the process just register themselves to the informer. And they tell the informer, I want information about these things. And the informer delegates it. So now we send only one request to the controller manager, and the informer delegates that request to whoever is responsible for finding out this information. The last thing I need to mention here is object priorities. If we have controllers that are responsible for objects, we can run into a problem where we have multiple controllers fighting to take control over the same object, right? So each object actually has an owner reference. If you look in the manifest in the database, you'll see that there's a field called an owner reference, and that will determine which controller is responsible for that object. Multiple controllers can race to get ownership over an object, but only one will succeed. The other one will receive an error. Okay, so going back to our example, not too complicated. The first thing that happens is the deployment controller is notified through a watch, right? And it notices that there's no replica set. So we've defined this state that we want. We want three Nginx instances, but there's no replica set. And it knows that that can't happen without a replica set. The deployment controller's responsibility is to build replica sets. And so it does that. And the way that it does that is through the API. If you haven't noticed, nothing talks to the database other than the API, which is a really important design principle as well. And so when the replica set is created, the replica set controller gets a notification, again, through a watch, through the informer, and it notices that there are no pods. This is another object, and the replica set controller is responsible for the pods object. So it creates them. Again, going back to extensibility, you can see how all of these logical pieces are separated. They're easy to think about. They all have very specific responsibilities. These are extendable. You can write your own controllers. And what people do, for example, because Kubernetes is so new, they've written cron job controllers, right? So if I want to write a controller that manages running crons on a particular schedule, I can do that. I can hook it up to the API, I can give it the access that it needs through role-based access control, and no problem. I can significantly modify the behavior of the cluster by doing this. So at this point, the replica set controller has added the pods. And those are in the database. Finally, we have another master component, which is the scheduler. And the scheduler's responsibility is to bind objects to nodes. So we've added these pods, the information about these pods, into the database, but we haven't decided where the pods should run. Right? We just know that we need these pods. And that's entirely the responsibility of the scheduler. Again, through exactly the same pattern, the scheduler is informed through the Kube API sends a watch to the scheduler. The informer then tells the scheduler what's changed, goes through a queue, scheduler picks it up. And then the scheduler does two things. It runs filter predicates and priority predicates. So filter predicates are basically saying, filter out all of the nodes where we can't run this object. Right? And it will consider things like resources. So it will go through all of the available nodes, and we know that our pod needs, let's say, 1 gig of RAM. Any node that doesn't have 1 gig of RAM available is filtered out. All of these filter predicates are just functions. So again, they're extendable. You can add your own filter predicate functions. At the end of that, you're going to have a list of nodes where the pod can run. What you don't have is a prioritized list of nodes. How do you know which node you choose from that list? That's the next step, which is the priority predicates. Again, same idea. List of functions. Each function runs in order. And they're weighted. So depending on how important you want these functions to be, at the end, you're going to come out with a prioritized list. And you're going to have a number one node, which is probably where this object will get scheduled. An example of this is, imagine you have a three node cluster and you want to deploy three pods. Do you expect one pod per node, or do you expect to fill up a node before going to the other ones? And this is a real scenario because if you're working in cloud, for example, you pay per node. So you might want to fill up your nodes to save on money. If you're running bare metal, you're already paying for the power consumption and having all that stuff running, so you probably want to distribute your applications for resiliency. If one node goes down, you're not disrupting all these different applications. Again, customizable, so you can add in your own predicates, whether they're priority or filter. So we'll get to the last point here. Now, all of the data is in the database. So the database tells us we have a deployment, which has a replica set, which has three pods, and those three pods are bound to some node. So that information is all in the database. Once objects get bound to a node, that's where the kubelet comes in. So the kubelet runs on all of your worker nodes. Right? If you have three worker nodes, you're gonna have three kubelets, one on each. And the kubelet is an agent for that node. It is responsible for making things happen on that node. Very importantly, it's an abstraction for the container runtime. So we could have the API just send requests directly to like a Docker daemon and say, bring up this container, because it knows we have the definition of the database. But what if we don't want to use Docker? What if we want to use some alternative like Rocket, right? Well, kubelet is the one that knows how to do this. It gets the data from the API, and then it makes it true. In this case, it's going to spin up our pods. Right? Kubelet actually takes input in a number of different ways. Localhost files, so if I put a manifest on the disk in the localhost, it'll make that true. You can also do command line, but in production, it's almost always going to be through the API. Okay. So this is what a Kubernetes cluster might look like. And we've talked about all of these different components. We start with kubectl at the top, which sends its request to the API server, where we handle authentication, authorization, we handle the admission chain, and then the API commits that data into that CD. When that data is committed, the initializers are informed, and they have an opportunity to act. And then the controller managers are informed, and they have an opportunity to act. And then the scheduler is informed that it has an opportunity to act. And when all of that is done, the database contains the complete desired state that we can make true. And finally, the kubelet will be informed as well, and then it will apply all of that onto the worker node, depending on where these things were scheduled. We're not going to talk about storage at all.
I thought one really good use case, I don't know if you guys are Java-based, but when you're running my Jenkins inside the cluster and the slave node, I mount the maven repository so it doesn't have to download onto the slave every time to pull the repository down to the node. So I just attach that volume every time. But in VMware, I could not figure out how to provision volumes automatically. I just maybe not perverse enough in VMware, but AWS it works perfect. But VMware is
much. We'll be deploying on bare metal, and so we don't have any storage backends that can hook into the cluster. So we basically said you don't get to put any state in the cluster right now.
That's probably.
Is the previous diagram fault tolerant?
Yes.
What if the master node goes down?
So, etcd is distributed. You're going to have multiple nodes. But all of these, API server, the controller manager, and the scheduler, are considered master components, and they are also running in high availability configuration. So you're going to have more than one master node. And you may or may not run your database along with these other components. It's recommended that you run your database, like for example, you have three nodes for etcd and nothing else. And then you have another three nodes for master components. And each master node has these three things, the API server, the scheduler, and the controller manager. So there are, in that case, three APIs, three schedulers, and three controller manager processes. And that's how you accomplish this high availability.
So the master nodes, they are in consensus with Raft?
Yes. Well, actually, I need to refresh my memory on that. I know that that's how etcd manages it, and I'm pretty sure that it's similar in the way that this works. One thing that you can do is you can either load balance against the API. So for example, when the controller manager on any of the node wants to hit an API, it can hit a load balancer and then get one of the APIs, but you don't know which. Or you can configure it to say only work with the local one. And in that case, if you only work with the local one, then you only have one master node that's ever doing work. All the other ones are just sitting idle.
But the information is replicated between them, yeah?
Well, they don't hold any state.
Oh, okay.
Right? So all of the state in the cluster is in etcd. They're only responsible for being informed when something changes and making a decision about what the next step is. But you can bring them down and update. They don't need to remember anything.
So they take over if one of they are in hot state, yeah?
Thank you.
We package that.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.